career development and preparing students, particularly minority students, for success. She currently is the Associate Vice President for Student Development, Dean of Students, and has extensive experience with Title IX. She's responsible for program and services, which is designed to assist and support students in achieving academic and personal success. In her previous position, she was the Dean of Students at Dillard University, which we're going to hear about this morning, where she emphasized effective leadership and management, outreach, planning, and effective program development to meet retention and student success goals. On a side note, I've known Dr. Lee before my time in Alaska, because we were both in New Orleans at the same time, and not only is she incredibly stylish, but she's incredibly dynamic and has so much experience that I enjoy learning from her every day. So with that, I'll turn it over to Dr. Lee.
Good morning. One second to get organized here. Good morning again. So I appreciate having the opportunity to come and spend some time with you this morning. What I'm going to talk about today is more of an experience, and I'm hoping at the end of it you're able to take away some information from my message that would help you in a situation. So, of course, Ryan said that I'm from New Orleans, Louisiana, and you know, a little storm came through about 10 years ago, a little bit over 10 years ago. So what I talk about is the ultimate living, learning community. Building community through chaos and crisis, a Katrina housing experience. What I want to do is talk a little bit about that experience from a housing residential perspective, particularly as it relates to the post-disaster response. When you're dealing with a crisis and you're at a primary residential campus, Dillard University is a small private liberal arts institution tucked away in the Gentilly community of New Orleans, which is primary residential. The community is, as well as the campus, we are a residential campus that can house anywhere from 75% to 80% of its residents. So you can imagine what happened in our thoughts August 29, 2005, when we've got thousands of students in our midst. So I'm going to get started with a video and talk a little bit.
Clap for this from the Lord, and it's going to rain. Rain real hard, and it rained for a real long time. 6 feet of water in the streets of Vandalia. River rolled all day, the river rolled all night. Some people got lost in the flood, some people got away all right. River had busted through, cleared out a black mile. 6 feet of water in the streets of Vandalia.
And felt like animals enslaved in a hot sun. Trash in the gutter, no food being filled, no water yet.
We should all go to heaven because I feel like we've lived through hell.
Right now, if I ever get out of this city, I'll never come back again. I'm this school and fresh and stressed out.
No, you keep your head away from the ceiling, okay?
True. You're trying to force us away.
Father, can you hear me? I'm calling on your name. Not Buddha nor Muhammad, but it's Jesus we cry out loud. Father, just forgive us. Hear us when we say,
University will not only survive, but it will be stronger and better.
Minimizing chaos in the process. These plans are typically developed with the intention of responding to an event or situation that could affect business continuity and the safety of the members of the university. And we do it the same. We typically write these plans with the thought that this could happen, this may happen, never expecting to actually have to put the plan into action. However, at Dillard, we have the advantage of literally every year, almost at the exact same time, we were able to activate our plan on a small scale. Hurricane season runs from June 1 to November 30, most active time, mid-August to mid-September. So every year between mid-August and mid-September, we would respond to the threat of a hurricane hitting the city of New Orleans or along the Gulf Coast. As a part of the plan, we would maintain MOUs with transportation services, bus services, as well as an agreement with a sister school, Centenary College in Shreveport, Louisiana, about 5 hours away. Centenary agreed to house our students. If it was over weekdays, they would provide some classroom space and our instructors would go with our students to avoid the loss of instruction time. We would return on a Monday. It usually lasts only 2 weeks, 2 days, sorry, 2 days. And ironically, we would typically evacuate the campus on a Thursday or a Friday. And so our students, as well as administrators, we thought, oh, we'd get a little mini vacation. We get Thursday, Friday, and the weekend off, and we can go somewhere else and just kind of relax. That was our routine. I worked at Dillard University for 12 years. Probably 7 of my 12 years, that was reality for us. Taking a mini vacation from New Orleans and from our campus. Monday morning, we come back and it's business as usual. We were never tasked with implementing the post-disaster portion of our plan. And for that, we were very grateful. We were never concerned because we would always find the campus just as we left it and our staff, students, faculty unharmed. We always knew that things could have been bad, but they never were. But we were always mindful of the potential, and we never took for granted that our campus and our city was spared. Once we would return, we would have a debrief after each mini vacation to review the plan. We had a good plan, a solid plan. We would discuss what happened, what went well, areas that we need to revisit within our plan. And we would discuss what would we do if things would have been worse, knowing all along that the major disaster could have happened, but once again, we were spared. But what happens when the could happen actually turns into does happen? You go from this. Dillard University is on 550 acres land. It's called a spacious green and gleaming white. Lots of green lawns and beautiful white buildings. On an absolutely beautiful campus, absolutely beautiful. It's been named one of the most beautiful campuses in the U.S. This, people affectionately call our students the lighthouses. From a distance, it kind of looks like that. You'll also notice, along here, these streets, called the Avenue of the Oaks, 100-year-old oak trees that line the avenue. This is where our commencement takes place. Students line up here, the dais is here, an absolutely beautiful site for commencement. Our hall rooms. Capricorn Plaza, a gathering spot for students between classes, hanging out. Another view of the Avenue of the Oaks. Exterior of the main building, main administrative building. What happens when you go from that to this? This is the same picture. Nor did they remember everything was off kilter at that time, so that's off the camera. This is what we saw. This is what happened. Our beautiful, spacious green and gleaming white the avenue of the oaks turned into the lake. Go from that to this. This is an aerial view of our campus. This is after the water started to subside. This is the back of a residential building. University police, totally destroyed. A building, a residential building, that burned. I didn't know that a building that was full of water could burn at the same time, but that happened. Electrical fires. This, lights up bright. This is Nelson Hall, a residential facility that had, this is a water line, over 8 feet of water. You can see here, it looks on this side. Give you the same treatment over here. This is the water line, 8 feet of water. This building also was destroyed by both water and fire. This is in Nelson Complex, Nelson Hall. This is a residential room. Mold, fire damage. This is where our students were living. Where their possessions were. Again, I mentioned having a standing MOU with our sister college, Centenary, 5 hours away. Again, they welcomed us again. However, with the impending news of a 5-category storm coming our way, we all knew we might be here a little bit longer. Here's our, some of our students at Centenary. Painstakingly watching news, watching what's happening in our city, in our school. This is heartbreaking for me, very difficult to watch. The early video showed a parting ceremony. We have a tradition where our students go through a ritual, a ceremony where they part from their families, become a part of our family. When I accepted students into my family, never did I think, or could I tell a parent, that once you turn your child over to me, they will have to sleep on the floor of the children. That's not what they were expecting. It's not what I was expecting, nor what I wanted for them. All of that happened because of this. Were we prepared? We had a plan, but we were truly, truly prepared. You know, as I said, we evacuated and would leave on a regular basis every year. But we took comfort in knowing that the campus would be the same. We would be back in 2 to 3 days, and it would be business as usual. But what happens? What do you do when you know you will not find the campus just as you left it? Things will never be the same. You activate as a campus community as never before. And you may think it's a simple matter of rebuilding. The mantra, if we build it, they will come, doesn't necessarily work in instances like this. Because we were not only dealing with the impact on the city and the images continually appearing in the media, but also the reputational risk of the institution. So I want to back up a little bit and tell you about the Katrina semester. Those of us that lived in New Orleans and lived through Katrina, we talk about our lives pre-Katrina, post-Katrina, and the Katrina semester or the Katrina summer. That Katrina semester, part of the early part of the video, was welcome week for our first year students. And they had been on campus for 1 week. The majority of our students are from out of state. So a hurricane was a very frightening thing for them, as it should be, but if you're not familiar, you've never gone through one, it's even more frightening for you. And particularly when the President of the United States gets onto the television and says a Category 5 storm is coming towards the Gulf of Mexico and New Orleans is in its line of sight. We had several hundreds of students on campus, their parents left for the parting ceremony with the understanding or the expectation that their children were safe.
Towards the end of the week, returning students were on campus. So we had our full 2,500. I know for some of your campuses, that's nothing. I'm at Dillard, UAA now, we've got 20,000. 2,500 students. That's a pretty good size for us, a small residential liberal arts campus. But still imagine that you have to maintain the safety in the midst of a Category 5 storm for 2,500 students. One of the things that our university president was mostly concerned about was the safety of students and locating students, making sure that they all evacuated the campus. Again, we had MOUs with a bus company, and so we had transportation available. And we evacuated our students, those who wanted to go, and had those who had other means of going other places, we allowed them to go. We did a checkout system to make sure we knew where everyone was. Now, we would evacuate to Centenary College every year, as I've stated before, with no problems. This time, halfway through the 5-hour trip, one of the buses caught fire. Now imagine, we're running from a storm. We have crisis within our crisis. Students have already lost everything that they left on campus, and the few things they were able to gather and take with them have burned up on us. In the meantime, we've got parents trying to reach us. There is no communication system. Cell phones are not working. Also, we had the death of two members of our family. You notice in the video, people were being rescued from the roofs of their homes. People evacuating to the Superdome. We did have employees, staff members that went to the Superdome, but then had to be evacuated because the dome was compromised when the roof came off. One of our graduating seniors, Tyresa Wells, 21 years old, from Dallas, Texas, evacuating the city of New Orleans, headed to Atlanta, Georgia, killed in a car accident. That tragic news made its way back to us. Dr. Lucius Weathersby, 37 years old, associate professor of music, died of a heart attack 2 days after the storm, the stress of the storm. So we continue to deal with the crisis within the crisis. We were fortunate that we only had the two men. Once we were able to galvanize and realize we were not coming back, we set up offices in Washington, D.C. and Atlanta, Georgia. So talk about what do we do next. Again, we've got this plan. We've activated the plan. But we've never had to activate the post-disaster portion of this plan. There was a harsh reality that we would not be coming back. More frightening is the fact that our city is destroyed. Students were sent to Centenary College, but once we realized they weren't coming back, we would not be having our typical semester. We began to send students home. That became a financial burden on students as well as our institution. But the outpour of support from other institutions and the nation at large was amazing. The citizens of Shreveport, Louisiana alone, where Centenary College is, raised $30,000 to send students home. We received other funds as well to get students to safety to their parents. Now, again, what about those who are from New Orleans? They have no home. So we had to find places to send them as well. And part of that included finding other institutions to send our students. And institutions were wonderful. And I don't know if any of you know whether or not your campuses took in any of our students. Thank you. Appreciate you. Our other campuses were responding amazingly. No cost, no tuition, free room and board. Just get here. That's all we want you to do, just get you, we want to support you. Setting up arrangements and agreements with our administration to support us in our efforts to provide safety for our students, particularly our graduating seniors. We wanted them to be able to finish the semester. And so it was important. So, when you're primarily a residential campus, capacity of your house, 75% to 80% of your student body, the immediate thought is, how do we provide housing accommodations in addition to instructional space? In terms of reputational risk factors, what do you say to the students, parents, the public, to ensure safety and a normal campus experience? What would be our need? Again, it was not a precedent in American academic history ever for the challenge of rebuilding a campus in the aftermath of a disaster like Hurricane Katrina. So what do you do? There's no best practice. Again, we're primarily a residential campus. There were no living spaces in the city. So even if we had learning spaces adequate for instruction, where would our students live? Large percentage of our student population were residents of New Orleans. So they, along with their families, lost everything, including the possessions on our campus and those that were on the bus, the few things they were able to take from the campus. Unlike our out-of-state students, they could go home. They only experienced the loss of things on campus. So what were we facing as a campus? Things. How do we build an ultimate living learning community? What we were facing was massive campus destruction and damage. 43 structures damaged or destroyed, 3 buildings burned while campus was still underwater. Total damages, about $400 million. Lost revenue from tuition and fees for the 2005-2006 academic year was over $25 million. There was major post-Katrina Dillard University capital losses. Infrastructure and cleanup efforts exceeded $280 million. There were limited resources and local government support. And I mention all that because we need money to bring our kids back. We need money for housing. We need money for instructional space. We're looking at our losses. The campus was located in a heavily impacted section of the city. The London Avenue Canal and Lake Pontchartrain levees breached, which is what really devastated the city. We, Dillard University, had 8 feet of standing water on its campus for 3 weeks. This was the largest displacement of students in the U.S. history. A little bit about New Orleans. Well, it's called Big Easy. Yes, you can come to New Orleans and have a good time. We are a college town. Several major universities. 75,000 college students in New Orleans at a typical time. It's estimated that's how many were there at the time of the Katrina. 75,000 college students, 2,500 of them belong to Dillard University. Again, primary residential campus. Another issue we were facing was locating the Dillard University family. Where were our administrators, students, faculty, and staff? Then managing the tragedy within the crisis, and I talked about the fires and the deaths. We also were dealing with the dismal impression of parents due to media accounts of the city. I'm sure all of you were glued to your televisions watching as a major city was going under, not knowing what would ever happen. And this is what we were dealing with as our parents were watching television. Once they got home, they're telling their kids, you are not going back. You will not be going back. We have to persuade faculty, staff, students to return. And then, of course, rebuilding the campus. So there was the question, do we do a temporary location in New Orleans, or do we just move somewhere else? Dillard University was founded in 1869, one of the oldest historically black colleges in the United States, has a big impact on the city of New Orleans, been responsible for a lot of things that have happened in terms of race relations, civil rights in the city of New Orleans alone, where it's located, its location is historical. And so that was not necessarily an option to relocate the campus. It would not feel the same. So we went back and forth on what we would do. But understanding the importance of the campus, we had to think about it. However, despite all the dismal news about the campus and the city, we took comfort in the fact that the floodwaters and the fire spared Alfred Lawless Chapel. This is important to the city of New Orleans and to our campus because this is one of the first places where Black and white people came together to gather, to talk about issues, and to come together as a worship place. It was an area to meet for cultural events long before integration was codified into law. So this place was important to us. And primarily because so there's a lot of history behind Dillard University, and particularly its strong legacy and history in New Orleans, as well as our commitment to our citizens and our students. So therefore, we had a mission to return. And this determination caused a crash course in crisis management, but particularly post-disaster response in terms of a residential. So to get started, our university president, Dr. Marlene Hughes, ordered a 12-city tour of town hall meetings. But first of all, how do you identify what 12 cities we need to go to? That was a big task in and of itself. So one of our takeaways was creating a better communication system. So we set up a 1-800 line, and that is what Dillard University uses now. In the event that we have to evacuate or leave each other, there is a 1-800 number, and within that system, there are individual numbers. If I was still there as a dean of students, my number at that time was 4. Dial the 1-800 number, hit 4, you get me. It will ring to a cell phone that I had. We also were given cell phones with out of the area codes. The area 504 area codes did not work on any of the phones for months. Could not use your phone until probably November, late October, November. Those systems crashed. So we set up a new phone system, a new communication system, identified where our students were, and held town hall meetings. We all met, we were scattered all over the place. What was important as related to the residential component of our campus was that we were all there to talk about what that would look like. And one of the things that I want to share that we did well was we never worked in silos or very isolated in terms of housing and our residential component. Everyone was involved, whether you worked in resident cipher housing or not. Our faculty, our staff members, they were all a part of that residential experience for our campus. So they were able to talk about the residential experience, what it was before and what it would be like when and if we returned. And of course, the biggest questions we got from our parents were, where will you live? Is the city safe? I'm looking at pictures, it's still underwater. How will they even get there? These were the things that we had. We had to totally rebuild the campus, motivate students to return, and convince parents that we'll provide a safe environment and a quality education. But another big question for administration was, where will we live? We were concerned about rebuilding a campus, but we also had to deal with the reality of rebuilding our own lives. I lost my own home. We had to deal with the safety and concerns of our own family, let alone our Dillard University family. And so while we're out on 12 city town hall meetings, we're trying to figure out what are we gonna do with our own families? What are we doing with our own lives? We don't have clothes to wear to these town hall meetings. What is it that we do? But we were committed to the process of bringing Dillard University back. So, what did we do? We talked about some options. And a major option was cruise ships. We're poor. I don't know if anybody cruised out of New Orleans before, but cruise ships are an option. They provided housing space, but very limited classroom space. Anecdotally, Tulane University housed 150 of their students on cruise ships. I have a picture of that I'll show in a minute. So after many talks and many options, we were calling downtown New Orleans Riverside Hilton our home. It was the first time in history that a campus, a full university, was operating in a fully functional hotel that was also open to the public. Not so bad. It provided space for living, learning, offices, a mailroom, dedicated space for laundry services, and a cafeteria that was once a restaurant. So this is the hotel here, two towers, connected to a shopping center, a plaza, and the river. Classrooms were being held out here, not too shabby. As soon as they like that, I would have meetings with my staff. These are classrooms, conference space. So imagine this room partitioned off. Classrooms. Nice dorm room, would you say? Students really enjoy it. Desk. One desk for you. A nice desk. Nice chair. This is the view, and these are the two towers of the building. And if you had a riverside view, this is what you woke up to. This is what you saw. I had a riverside view on the 21st floor. It's very nice. This is a picture from inside the hotel. This is the World Trade Center, New Orleans. After about a month, we were able to secure some office space on the top floors of this building. We were growing in terms of our space within the hotel, so we had space here. I had an office here, but because I wanted to be closer to the students, I lived there, and think how much closer can you get, it was important for me to be a part of the experience with them. So while they were in the Hilton and classrooms, I literally would set up office wherever, in the lobby, in the hallway, outside the conference rooms, because I wanted to be with the students. They had already gone through a very traumatic experience and didn't want to be across the street. And you would think, well, across the street, that's not a big deal. Our students were dealing with some strong emotional issues, and I wanted to be there for them. Talked about the cruise ships. There's two of them here. So it was here in the hotel, Tulane University here. Their campuses were spared certain buildings, so they were able to go back to campus for instruction. Dillard University was the only campus that was totally destroyed, instructional space as well as living space. You know, food wasn't too bad either. It still had full restaurant services, and one of the restaurants was turned into the Blue Devil Cafe. The university's mascot is the Blue Devils. So we had our own dedicated restaurant cafeteria. Now, we did have some challenges, as any residential component in housing would have, in terms of engaging students. So our competition was Harris Casino, right across the street. Beautiful downtown. Bourbon Street, anybody who's partaking of Bourbon Street. It was two blocks away, so you can imagine what that like. Although our students would find their way to Bourbon Street anyway, we made it even easier for them to get to Bourbon Street. Beautiful. I mean, who wouldn't want to hang out down there? So, the student experience. We wanted to make sure that students were engaged, that we created those same types of opportunities for activities and engagement that we would create on the campus and we've been living in normal conditions. So these are some quotes from some students. We were constantly being visited by the media, and there were a couple of newspaper articles, and I've kept some of them. These are some of the quotes. I felt like a celebrity in the hotel. I had hot wings and chicken tenders delivered to my room. And employees clear your food when you're finished eating in the lobby restaurant, which is now the Blue Devil Cafe. On campus, you have to clear your own plate. Yes, you do. Today, I called when we were running out of toilet paper. They were there in 2 minutes. You don't normally get that in the dorms. This is so nice. You expect this kind of living if you're on vacation. But I didn't know the administration would make sure things were so nice for us. After what we went through and watched on the news, this is great and I'm so thankful. I don't know why I'm going to get up and go to class. A full-size comfortable bed and not a small twin bed with a terrible flat hard mattress like in Williams, one of our halls. I can't be late for class. I only have to take the elevator down 8 floors. I need a good excuse, but I can't think of one. So we contracted space, 500 double occupancy beds. We had floors 4 through 8 for our students and 20 up for faculty staff. We wanted to create some separation so that we could kind of feel like we're not really living with them. When the campus reopens, do we have to move back into housing? This is too good. We can walk to Bourbon Street, Harris, and sit out on the river to study. We don't know if that was really happening. They were sitting on the river for sure. Studying. Life is good. We didn't have to bring anything except ourselves. Pillows, sheets, comforters. It was all there for us. It was a relief. I was just so happy to see everybody. This is when we returned on January 2nd. This is a family. I was happy to see my family. There were hugs, kisses, and even tears when we all first saw each other on January 9th, first day of class. It was emotional. We hadn't seen each other since we left campus in August. And to be in such comfort and safety at the Hilton Hotel and our Hotel Dillard made it even better. I'm so happy to be back home, back at Dillard. No matter that it's a hotel, we are together. The best thing for me has been having the entire Dillard family living together. Going through this experience together and recovering together is wonderful. Dillard is so much more to us than a campus, it's a community. And those are the things that were so important to me to hear students talk about, the family aspect, the community aspect, that they appreciated that we all were living together. I want to share a little bit. We expected 800 students. We had space for 1,000. Once students showed up on January 2nd, they were literally calling their friends, it's okay, the water's gone, you can come, it's safe here. We ended up with almost 1,500 students at the Hilton Hotel, an operating hotel within the city. For us, the takeaways, what I want to share with you, the takeaways were the student experience. It's important to note that these takeaways didn't just occur as a result of us going to the Hilton Hotel. For students to have a feeling of family, community, appreciation, we have to have been practicing that long before the disaster hit. Students particularly hit on three things: community, they touched on teamwork, the way they talked, and trust. We created a sense of community for them. That happened because we operated as a team long before we got to the campus, and we created trust for our students. So I got 10 minutes, so I'm gonna rush through this. So just some pictures of the community aspect. This lady right here became part of our community. Michelle Obama came to visit and gave a commencement speech. The community aspect, and this is what they were reflecting on. This is not on our campus. Katrina, but they were reflecting on the fact of community, that we are community, and we continued that at the hotel. Teamwork, we all came together. Dillard University has a requirement of 120 hours of community service, minimum. So our students were accustomed to working together and giving that. And trust, they trusted us. They trusted us before the disaster, before we took them to campus, but even more so after. And I looked up definition of trust last night as I was preparing. Of course, we always know, yeah, I trust. What does that really mean? It's to rely upon or place confidence in someone or something. The obligation or responsibility imposed on a person in whom confidence and authority is placed. Our students and our parents, they trusted us. So we could not let them down. Especially the parents, many of them who themselves were Dillard University graduates. So the legacy has to continue. So it was important for us to not only get students through Katrina, but we wanted to properly end this chapter for our graduating seniors. So campus was prepared, visually, the buildings were still gutted on the inside. They had been pressure washed to have the gleaming white. The yard was spray painted green to have the luscious green. After completing their final semester at New Orleans Hilton Riverside, Dillard University seniors returned to the Avenue of the Oaks to graduate the summer of 2006. It was Dillard's 137th commencement. And it was important for us, campus, community, that our graduating seniors saw Dillard as they remembered it, the spacious, green, and beautiful. This is the commencement. You'll notice these are our graduating seniors on the Avenue of the Oaks, headed to the White House, which is really Kearney Hall. You'll notice these flags. Over 200 schools hosted our students, particularly our seniors. And we wanted to pay homage to them. We invited them to the commencement, even though they all could not come. But these are flags that we had made that symbolize every host school. And while I had been at Dillard at that time for probably 8-9 years, I probably cried at only one commencement. This was the second, and I cried the whole time. It was the fact that we were back home, and our graduating seniors were graduating, and we were grateful to these schools that supported us through a major crisis. Quote from a graduate. This has been our home for 4 years. If we had graduated anywhere else, there wouldn't have been a sense of closure. And that's what we wanted for our students. So, some lessons learned really quick. I've got 5. Thank you, Ryan. It's important to maintain an updated, effective disaster recovery plan. We had one, we had a chance to implement it regularly. Communication is key. Communicating with each other in the time of disaster and making a way to communicate, but more importantly, sharing the experiences and what it means to be a part of a community. We talked regularly about the Dillard experience, what it means to be a Dillard University student, the legacy that comes with being a Dillard University student. And because we communicated that on a regular basis, it was important that our students came back to us. Maintain standing MOUs and contract services. I talked about the bus service. Make sure you get one that has good buses that don't catch fire at the time that you really need them. And MOUs with universities close by. Connect with local colleges and universities. We always have these universities right in our back. But we never really communicated or implemented things together. Since this happened, there are strong ties between the institutions in the city because we never know when this will happen again. We have to rely on each other. It takes a village. Independence versus interdependence. We had to realize that while we were independent departments within Dillard University, we were all interdependent upon each other, and that became very obvious when it was time to go on those 12 city town hall meeting tours to talk about the experience and what the residential housing experience would look like. We relied upon people outside of the division to help us tell the story. The city becomes a school laboratory. We turned the experience into a research project for our students. We blended the residential and academic experience through the research that our students were doing. And then connecting campus resources, understanding that we all have to do this together. But most importantly for me, the takeaway were the experiences of the students and what they shared with us. It's important to be a community, not only to proclaim that you're a community, but to live as a community, to exhibit teamwork. Because as a team, we were able to exhibit that. Our students saw it and they mimicked it. And trust, building trust within our students and the community that we lived in trusted that we would come back, and when we came back, it vitalized the community and the residents of that community came back. And building trust, trusting our team members, and when we trust each other, it reflected in the way we communicated with our students and our parents. So, I hope that you would never have to go through such a devastating experience. But if you do, understanding that there are some key components to being able to really go through this experience and come out unscathed. Will we ever forget? No. Can we overcome something else? Sure. I want to thank you all. I know I'm probably over time now. Thank you so much. I appreciate having the opportunity to come and just talk about my experience and to share with you some takeaways and best practices in terms of crisis management, particularly right now when we're dealing with so many different things on our campuses, and I hope that you are able to glean some information from this. Thank you very much, and enjoy the rest of the day.
Thank you very much, Dr. Lee, for coming and sharing your story today. Can you give a warm round of applause?